Welcome home. I'm happy to see so many familiar faces tonight, and a little grayer than I remembered. But it's nice to see you here, and there's so many great faces. I'm Jeff Huff. I'm the COO of South Florida PBS. From what we know about Paul, I think he would probably appreciate it very much if we would make the effort to celebrate his life rather than mourn his passing, and I'll bet you any money he'd raise a glass to that. I want to make a couple personal comments before we get going. It was a little over 40 years ago that I first walked into these doors. I was hired by Grover Cole. Grover Cole was an art director at CBS before he came here, and he worked on the Jackie Gleason show. I think that's where I first got my first bug about working on a national show. And I worked with a few very talented people who moved on to CBS. They moved on to NBC, HBO. And honestly, I wanted nothing less. I got my shot at NBC, and for a lot of reasons, I just couldn't go. And boy, did I just mope around these halls. And but let me tell you something about these walls. This place is filled with inspiration. And it's the only way that I can figure out how 15 or 20 people could get together and make a miracle. And they did. 37 years later, there isn't a day that I don't look on my desk at a candy jar that I have that has a WPBT2 on one side and it has the NBR logo on the other. And I remember the blood and the sweat that went into making the nightly business report. And I thank God that I had the opportunity to work with so many wonderful people over the years, many of whom are here tonight. And I am thankful that I had the honor and the privilege to work with Linda O'Brien. And as you see and you know, that Linda's with us here tonight, and I asked her to lead us one more time. Lead us so that we could celebrate the life of Paul Kangas. Please welcome Linda O'Brien.
Thank you, my friend, Jeff, my colleague, long time, and I'm so glad Grover Cole hired you when he did. You can't believe it's been all those years. Our thanks to Jeff and to Dolores and to all our friends at South Florida PBS who have made this day possible. You've done beautiful work to transform the studio. It does remind you of the NBR days, and Susie Garb pointed out, this is the NBR time. This is when we go live. So here we are. Paul Kangas, we're going to celebrate his life. He was larger than life. He was an icon, a leader, and we have all benefited in large ways and small ways by knowing Paul. For 30 years, he broadcast out of this very studio to become one of the most well-known and beloved anchors on public television. And when I think of Paul, I'm really reminded of the words of Theodore Roosevelt, who said, "It's not the critic who counts. It's the man who points out how the strong man stumbles or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. The credit belongs to the man actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood," and you said it, "and who strives valiantly, who errs, because there is no effort without error, without shortcoming, but who does actually strive to do the deeds, who knows great enthusiasm, the great devotions, who spends himself in a worthy cause, who at the best knows in the end the triumph of high achievement." Paul Kangas knew high achievement. He knew many victories. He was never timid. His arena was this studio. He knew great enthusiasm, and he spent his life on a worthy cause, and that was educating viewers. He practically jumped through the screen with his knowledge and his passion for financial news. He advocated for financial news. How many times did NBR's first original producer, Jack Kahn, and Paul go back and forth on timing? Do you remember this? So Paul would say, I just need one more minute, especially it could be Stocks 1 or Stocks 2, as they were affectionately known. And it wasn't because Paul wanted more airtime. No, no, never. Paul wanted to make sure that viewers got the information that they needed. And he always had one more piece of analysis, one more bit of information he wanted to share with them. So he wanted to make sure they would be well informed so that they could make better decisions with their investments and their life savings. The fondest story I recall about Paul is the viewer, and many of you know this story, who called Paul once a week and did this for years. She couldn't see too well. She was older. She was in her 90s. But she didn't trust anyone else but Paul to tell her how her stocks were doing. So week after week, Paul would take her call and he'd go over her portfolio of stocks and let her know how they closed out that week. And one day, he just asked her, well, how many shares do you have? This one particular stock, I believe it was AT&T. And she told him, he did the math, he realized this wonderful little lady was worth millions of dollars, millions, but she trusted no one else but Paul Kangas. Paul built long-lasting relationships with financial experts on Wall Street and around the country who helped inform him and provide the depth and context to his nightly commentary. Personal financial commentator Jonathan Pond and Paul hit it off right from the beginning. Jonathan, of course, did a series of public television personal finance specials, all produced by Jack Kahn, and one of those segments took place right outside these studios in the parking lot, and Paul and Jonathan had what can only be described as an interesting conversation. Let's take a look.
Now, you may think that driving around in an old car is good in theory, but You might think that people who drive around in old cars are just above the poverty. What's going on? Paul, is that you?
Hi.
Paul Kangas of the Nightly Business Report. Quite a machine here.
Very dependable.
What is it?
Very old. 1983 Caprice Classic Chevrolet. About 88,000.
Is it?
I love
wonderful
it.
Wonderful car.
It's been a wonderful car.
Now, why would a person of your stature want to drive around in an old car?
Well, first of all, I don't have to worry about theft.
Okay.
It's very dependable. The car does not know what collision insurance is. And not only that, but every 10 days, I double its value when I fill it with gas.
Well, I think if somebody like Paul Kangas is driving around in a 13-year-old car, I would say my case is closed.
Make that 12.
Unbelievable. And Paul definitely took Jonathan's advice to heart, which was living beneath your means, and certainly with that Chevy. That Chevy was amazing. He loved that car, and so did we all loved it. And we knew, because Paul would drive back and forth, and we knew when Paul was nearby and sometimes coming very short, right few minutes before airtime, but always made it. Paul's passion for financial news and educating others didn't stop with viewers. He mentored many individuals in the NBR newsroom, and many of them are here tonight, and others are in other areas, and they're probably thinking about Paul right now. But he helped create a generation of savvy business news producers and writers. It didn't matter what role you played at NBR, producer, writer, floor manager, ENG operator, director, Paul's enthusiasm was infectious. And how can we forget the late and great Doug Brink and his love for gold investing? Remember that? He loved talking about it, and he would direct it. He was taking all of this in from Paul's great knowledge. I know of colleagues who worked to pay off their mortgages in a very smart and savvy way because of Paul's influence. Others took to heart the notion of saving and investing for education or for retirement. Many of the NBR alumni went on to careers in business journalism, cable television, national financial publications, dot-coms, even the Federal Reserve. Two went to the Federal Reserve. It's pretty amazing. And several started their own businesses. Many credited Paul for his ability to explain and comment complex financial news in a very clear and understandable way. And I remember myself writing, one of my first jobs was to write gold and silver and the dollar. And this was all new to me, really new, but I would call Paul and he would help me out and he would give me the information I needed. And he could explain things like no one else I've ever heard. Not just about stocks and bonds, but just life. And in the early days, Paul was also broadcasting a radio segment on WINZ. And as you remember, he'd go back and forth. He had that home studio, and he would do I don't even know how many radio shows he would do, these programs. And then he'd do his writing here. He'd go back. He'd change. He'd come back in his jacket and tie, all ready to do national news on NBR. I do not know to this day how he kept up that pace. And I keep thinking we're going to see Paul come by in that Chevy and drive up any moment. How can we forget Paul's rapid-fire delivery? He drove the closed captioning people nuts. They could not keep up with him. In fact, if you looked at stocks too, they just gave up. There was no closed captioning. I'm glad the FCC never looked at it too carefully. He just had the most amazing voice, that resonance, that assuring voice, combined with deep knowledge. It was an amazing combination. And Paul was there for some of the most amazing times in our nation's history. When you think about it, when NBR started, the oil shocks of the 1970s, the volatility of interest rates, deregulation of the airlines, remember Alfred Kahn, turbulence in the early Reagan administration, the Laffer Curve, written on a napkin, one of our early commentators, the birth of NAFTA that we hear about so much today, the dot-com bubble, the mortgage crisis, and many, many more. In December of 2009, Paul and a number of colleagues and I traveled to New York at Fordham University for the 7th annual Emmy Awards for Business and Financial Reporting. And it was a great honor for me to stand with Paul to receive this Emmy Lifetime Achievement. And Paul was just amazing. He was cited for his lifetime work that underpinned by his deep knowledge of financial markets. And here's what the Emmy folks said. They said, known for his fast-paced delivery, his sharp wit, his encyclopedic knowledge of financial markets, Paul Kangas was a South Florida stockbroker when he joined NBR as a stock market commentator in 1979. Think about that. By 1980, he'd became the show's co-anchor. He reported on all the major financial events of the last three decades, from market bubbles to bull runs to bear runs. Paul's Lifetime Emmy Award was presented just before he retired from this program, and it capped a great career by our friend and colleague. Steve Forbes introduced him that evening. Paul Kangas was there, Rodney Ward, Susie Garib. It was quite a moment. And all I thought of is how much we owe to Paul and his vision and his drive. Our deepest sympathy go to Paul's family, especially his son Mark, who is with us tonight, who took such good care of Paul for so many years. From the time he retired, Mark was there, has been there, and I just know that Paul is smiling right now to think that you're here, Mark, and that we're all together in sharing in this wonderful lifetime. Thank you for all you have done. Thank you for sharing your father with us for so many years, 30 years or more. And God bless you, Paul. Please come up, Mark, and say a few words.
Thanks, Mike. How are you? Thank you. Well, I got to tell you, this is great. You guys putting this on for Paul, absolutely wonderful. I can't thank you enough. Jeff, Melissa, everybody. It's one of those bittersweet moments. We go back, I'm not going to tell you the whole thing, don't worry. But I met Paul, I was probably around 14. He married my mom. And he was doing the parent thing for a while, and I didn't really get to know what he was like, really. The last 7 years after my mom passed, I ended up moving in, and he became my best friend. And I know he's a great man, and a lot of you know that he's a sweetheart of a man also. And just want to say thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mark. And he was a sweetheart of a man. We were talking about it earlier. I don't think I ever heard Paul ever even get into an argument. I mean, he just didn't. If there was any tense moments, he diffused it with a great line or something humorous. He was truly a great man. So next, we're going to be hearing from some of our wonderful staff members from NBR. Jack Kahn, I believe, is next up. Jack?
Thank you, Linda, and great to see you all here again after so many years. For those of us who worked with Paul in NBR's earliest days, the defining moment, I think, came on October 19th, 1987, which came to be known as Black Monday. On that day, the Dow Jones Industrial Average dropped 508 points. That may not seem so huge now, but it was a decline of 22.6%. The largest single-day percentage drop before or since. This happened almost exactly 6 years after NBR went national, and our only real competition at the time was CNN, which wasn't even available to most people since cable TV was still in its infancy. So on that night, I'm sure that the record number of viewers tuned into NBR and waited for Paul to fill them in on the details of what happened. Of course, with no internet in those days, Paul didn't have many sources of information, just the wires and his phone, and I remember him frantically trying to get through to his sources on Wall Street that afternoon. Working right up to airtime, Paul then did what he did on any normal day. He wrote down the points he needed to reference on a tiny scrap of paper, got his makeup applied, and went down to the studio to make his report. But even though he tried to stay cool, it was hard for him to hide his astonishment at the extent of the carnage in stock prices. Let's take a look at his analysis of the hour-by-hour activity in that night's Stock One segment.
New York Stock Exchange Chairman John Phelan declined to characterize today's market action as a crash, saying what happened was a significant correction after a five-year run-up. And he said the exchange will open as usual tomorrow morning. But first, for the specifics of what happened to stocks today, here's Paul.
As panic selling erupted on those foreign stock exchanges, as you just heard, prices on the New York Exchange continued to plunge early today in an extension of last Friday's record one-day loss of 108 and a third points on the Dow Industrial Average down to the 2246 level. The opening sell-off was massive as the Dow plummeted 201 points by 11 a.m. with 1,600 stocks down and a mere 70, mostly precious metals issues, moving higher while the tape was running over an hour late. What was the cause of this wholesale liquidation? Our frequent market monitor guest, Jim Stack, editor of the Investech Letter, who was worried about the bull market on his last visit with us on June 5th, told me one of the major factors, if not the major factor, was forced mutual fund redemptions. Add to that the downside pressures exerted by snowballing portfolio insurance and futures-related selling, and the industrial average tumbled to a 271.5-point loss by 2 p.m., with only 50 stocks up, 1,850 down. With not even a hint of any meaningful technical rebound, stocks continued to plunge on record volume throughout the afternoon, with the Dow off 296 points at the 1950 level at 3 p.m. The final hour saw the bottom drop out as more margin call and mutual fund liquidations, combined with all those wonderfully innovative computer-driven strategies, well, they pummeled the Dow Industrial Average down to a record loss of 508.32, putting it at 1,738.74, which is also by far a record percentage loss of 22.5%. No available high or lows. They're still figuring out. The tape was 2 hours and 10 minutes late at the final bell. Trading volume, obviously a huge record, 604.4 million, and 1.1 million shares of up volume, nearly 603 million shares of down volume. The Dow Transports tumbling a record 164 and 3/4 points. Utilities down a record 29.16. Dow 65, a record loss of 168 and a half points. And the closing tick showed no mercy, still a very negative minus 933. Standard & Poor's 500, oh, these are all record drops, 57.87, 67-point loss in the 400, the 100 off over 58 points. SPOC 250 down 30 and a third. New York Stock Exchange Index itself down 30 and one-half points. NASDAQ tumbled 46.12. Value Line off 30 and two-thirds points. And the Wilshire 5000, a record loss of 503 and a fraction.
Well, I think you could see that Paul's calm demeanor kept many a mom-and-pop investor from panicking that night. And his unique view of this market is missed. I'd like to pass the mic on to Paul's longtime anchor, co-anchor, Susie Garib, who also has some memories of Paul to share. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. I'm so honored to be here with you today to speak about Paul, and also so happy to see many familiar faces, and I haven't been in the studio in a long time. I worked with Paul Kangas for 12 years. We were co-anchors of Nightly Business Report from May 1st in 1998 to December 31st, 2009, and that was Paul's last show he did before he went off for retirement, and I had the privilege and the honor of doing that last New Year's broadcast with him. I loved working with Paul, and who didn't? You've already heard from so many people saying the same thing, but he was smart and business savvy. He was kind. He was humble. He was sincere. He was warm and had a charming personality. He was a gentleman, which is really a rarity in this ego-filled, very competitive world of television that we all live in. And I think, Linda, you're right. I never heard him raise his voice. I never heard him argue and swear or anything like that that you hear in most newsrooms around the country, believe me. He had a big heart, and he was funny, as you saw in that video clip with Jonathan Pond. And he always had a witty joke and that unforgettable, big, hearty laugh. So when I think of his whole life all together, I'm more inclined to smile and laugh than to cry. But, you know, as I was reflecting about Paul, I think the most impressive thing about him was his gift of connecting with people. We all have stories about Paul, don't we? He had relationships with all of us, and he also had great relationships with his fans, including that 90-some-year-old lady. Wherever I would go, people would ask me about Paul. They adored him, and you know, they'd want to know everything about him. And I'd come back and I'd tell Paul, you know, I was in such and such a place, and you know, people were asking all about you. And he'd just smile and say, "Well, is that so?" He'd always say, "Is that so?" And when I'd press him, I'd say, "No, Paul, I mean, really, they want to know everything from, you know, the clothes you wear to how your views on various stocks. They want to know what it's like to be with Paul Kangas in real life." And he'd just say, "Well, I'll be." He was incredibly humble about his star status. In fact, I think he'd be shocked to see this big shindig that we're throwing for him tonight. My own personal connection with Paul began the week before I started working at Nightly Business Report, and it was here in Miami at dinner. Linda O'Brien and Rodney Ward had arranged a dinner for me to meet with some members of the NBR team, and they seated me right next to Paul. And actually, he did most of the talking. He started by telling me about his years of living in Cleveland. That was his point of connection with me because I grew up in Cleveland. He told me about working on the Coast Guard in Cleveland. He loved the Coast Guard. He just didn't like those brutal cold winters of Cleveland. The only good thing about Cleveland, he said, is that's where he met his wife, beautiful Penny. And then he showed me a black and white photo that he had of Penny. And to be honest with you, it might have been her high school graduation picture. She was very young. But that's the picture he kept in his wallet. And I thought, what a sweet, sentimental thing to know about my new co-anchor. He told me about growing up in Michigan, Upper Peninsula, also a cold area, and how his father, a dentist, wanted him to be a dentist. And he said he actually gave it a try. I think he enrolled in dental school, but then quickly dropped out. And it just wasn't for me, he told me. Well, how lucky for us that, and for millions of investors, that Paul became an expert, stock market expert, a great newscaster, instead of becoming a dentist. The funny thing about Paul that I realized later was that he's really not a big talker. He's more of a man of few words. But that night, he oozed charm, and he entertained me with so many stories, because Paul, who's got this gift with relationships, wanted me to feel like I belonged in the NBR family. And he wanted to make me feel comfortable. And boy, did he do a great job of it. Such a good job that it's no wonder that the first program that we ever co-anchored, it was about a week or so later, even though I was in the NBR studio in New York and Paul was hundreds of miles away here in Miami, the show came off remarkably routine. It was as if we had done this many, many times and for many years. We felt the connection to each other. I think viewers felt it too, and it only got better and better over the years. As I reflect back on the more than 3,000 shows that Paul and I did together, Melissa, you have to tell me if that number is right, but I think it's something like that. I think of all of the historical news events that we covered and we reported and we analyzed, and Linda mentioned some of them, and I just think about how that amazing experience connected Paul and me in the most wonderful way. We saw the same things. We felt the same things. The joy and the sadness of a lot of the news, the excitement and the disappointments. So here are some of my memories of that time. We experienced many market milestones together. The Dow hitting 10,000, then 11,000, then the march to 14,000. We rang the closing bell at the New York Stock Exchange on three important occasions: the 20th anniversary of Nightly Business Report, the 25th, and the 30th. We went through the millennium and into the new century together, and we survived Y2K in the process. We saw the 9/11 tragedy. We saw the market meltdown in the aftermath. We saw the Lehman Brothers collapse. We saw the amazing IPO of Google and the sensational launch of Apple iPhones and iPads. We saw the irrational, exuberant years with Alan Greenspan. We saw the financial crisis with Ben Bernanke. We saw the same things, we felt the same things. We were bonded by the experience of going through all that together. We shared something that happened live before our very eyes every single day. And those experiences, I think, created something unique between us. And even though we walked off the set at night and went our separate ways in separate cities, we were still connected. You know, legacy is a very overused word these days, but with Paul Kangas, I think it's fair to say he left behind a very real legacy. I feel honored to have known him and have worked with him. And my sadness of losing Paul is lessened only slightly by the comforting thought that I had the special privilege of knowing him. So when I mentioned when Paul retired back in 2009, we took a look back at his long career with NBR. So let's go to the videotape.
The Nightly Business Report.
The year is 1979, and Nightly Business Report goes on the air with Paul covering stocks. The stock market's performance in the first month of each new year has generally foreshadowed its overall performance for the remainder of that particular year.
Prices on the New York Exchange continued to plunge early today in an extension of last Friday's record one-day loss of 108 and a third points on the Dow Industrial Average down to the 2246 level.
Over the years, as co-anchor, Paul is the steady voice of reason through news events good.
It's another major milestone for the Dow. A close above 10,000 for the first time in the blue chip index's history.
And bad.
America still reels from a staggering attack, a wave of horror that shook the country.
Over the years, his list of interview guests included well-known names both inside and outside the world of business.
Is value investing as put forward by Graham and Dodd of any value any longer?
Oh, yes, it is, Paul. If you think about it from a common sense standpoint, when you buy a share, you buy a share in order to participate in the profits of that corporation.
Over the years, has your celebrity on balance been a positive or a negative for your family?
Well, it has to be a positive. I mean, I've had a lot of great things happen to me, and I've gotten to be, well known and respected around the country. And
I should say, yes.
and the family, gets a lot of recognition for that.
Over the years, his Friday Market Monitor interviews became the hallmark of his work, a factor that led one newspaper to dub him the Walter Cronkite of Business News.
I just want to say what a pleasure it's been to work with you and to interview with you for almost the last 15 years. It's always been challenging in dealing with somebody who knows the field so well that I know whenever I talk with him, I'd better be on my P's and Q's and have my facts right.
Paul? Well, I just looked to see when my first show was with you, and it was 1984, and that is 25 years ago. And altogether, we've done 50 shows together.
Paul, it was 26 years ago that you first invited me to appear on the Nightly Business Report. That was in 1983, at Dow 1200. We've been through three recessions, one market crash, and two of the biggest bear markets in Wall Street history. It's been a long run, but you've been a voice of reason to NBR viewers through it. That's not only invaluable, but it's been priceless for the viewers. We're all going to miss you. Congratulations on over 30 years and the best of goodbyes.
And this year, two special recognitions of three decades of hard work. A Lifetime Achievement Emmy Award by the National Academy of Television Arts and Sciences. And recognition in a big way, literally. His picture is emblazoned on the tower at the NASDAQ market site in Times Square in New York City, seven stories high above the crossroads of the world.
And Paul, while tonight, December 31st, marks an ending, it also marks a beginning. And it's a New Year's Eve, and it's a new chapter in your story. And I just want to say, as I was looking at all those highlights, I was thinking of our stories over the last 12 years. We've shared so many memories. And, as I was thinking about them, a lot of our memories happened right here at the New York Stock Exchange. Do you remember we rang the bell for the 20th anniversary of Nightly Business Report, the 25th anniversary? And just in January, you were here with me, and we rang the bell for the 30th anniversary of Nightly Business Report. And I guess, one of my fondest memories of our time together over these last 12 years was on December 31st, New Year's Eve, 1999, we were preparing for the Millennium Show, and you and I decided we would wear black tie, as we are tonight. It was a very special time, as is tonight. And I just reflect back that it's been a lot of fun working with you. You've been a terrific co-anchor, a wonderful friend, and I really am going to miss you.
And ditto on that terrific co-anchor, as far as I'm concerned. It's been a great experience, wonderful crews, and a lot of good stories, and you're an excellent interviewer.
Oh, well, you're the best. And I just want to say that I'm sure I speak for everybody from Nightly Business Report, whether they are working with you in Miami or up here in New York. We're all wishing you the best of goodbyes.
That's very kind of you indeed, Susie. Very nice indeed.
Truly a gentleman. We're all congratulating him, and he congratulates us. I now like to ask Rodney Ward, where are you, Rodney, to come up here and share his thoughts on Paul. Rodney was a big part of the NBR team that led the program for many years. I had to read the teleprompter. I knew that in my heart.
Well, Well, I've just been taking these pages apart that I have here, following Linda, Susie, and Jack. I don't know what more there is to say. But I've been thinking a lot about this time and about being here and speaking about Paul. And I know we all have our remembrances, our personal remembrances and stories. He made us laugh. He made us think. I had a chance to say goodbye to Paul. He was alone in the hospital room at hospice. And on the table at the door was a framed greeting with his name that also noted he served in the United States Coast Guard. And we all know how proud Paul was of having served his country and being in the Coast Guard. But it was so fitting that it was there and we talked about service, because that was what Paul was all about. You know, for most of my adult life, and for many of you here, we worked together on a program whose foundation was built upon the integrity, dedication, and commitment of Paul Kangas in providing his nightly stock market coverage, but more importantly, providing knowledge to everyone. There were no bells, there were no whistles or other sound effects or flashy graphics. There was Paul giving his audience an honest assessment of the markets. Paul was a person who was also unafraid to speak truth to power, whatever that power may have been. But what the audience saw was only a part of Paul, the person that we who work with him got to know. You know, I think back to the early days of NBR and being at Paul's house, and that guitar-playing guy hanging from gravity boots and the vodka stored in the freezer. But what I think I will cherish most about Paul in my memories is a working relationship that turned into a friendship and a bond between Paul and one of his stock producers, Johnny Streets. There were a lot of things that I will remember, but most of all, I will remember that bond, that trust, that friendship that grew in that nightly business report. And he taught me about trust through that friendship. He taught me about friendship through that friendship. He taught me about what it takes to truly be there when someone needs you. So thank you, Paul. I learned a lot, not only about stocks, but a lot about life. Thank you very much. And I'm here now to introduce Tom Hudson.
I feel like we need a Kailhoff interstitial here or something, right?
Ed, you want to sing us a couple of bars, maybe?
Oh, no, no.
No, no, okay, fair enough. I can't tell you how humbled and proud I am to be back here at this building and to be welcomed back into NBR as I was welcomed in 2009 with Paul. Mark, my sympathies to you and the family. I know that you and I had lunch recently, and it was wonderful to hear some of those stories, and you have shown the real dedication as a son to a father. So I know that that probably meant a lot to you and to him as well. You know, it had been about 3 years since Nightly Business Report had moved to New York, and probably about 6 years since Paul had been on television. I found myself in Coconut Grove at a restaurant for a late lunch meeting. And I got there early, so I sat by the hostess station waiting for my colleagues to come. And there weren't a lot of people in the restaurant, just a couple of people lingering around with the late coffee. And a couple of guys got up and they walked right by me toward the door, and one of them stopped in his tracks and turned around. And he came up to me. And I looked up, I'm sure I was probably on my phone doing something, and I looked up and he looked at me, and he had that little sparkle of recognition that sometimes you get when you're on TV or on the radio of something familiar about you, but they're not quite sure, they can't quite place it just there. And he said, "Aren't you?" And so I stood up and I was ready to shake his hand and introduce myself to help jog his memory. And right as I opened my mouth, he said, "The guy that replaced Paul Kangas?" I said then, and what I said in late 2009 and 2010 and 11, and I still say today very proudly, nobody could replace this guy. I followed Paul. I had the great luck of following Paul. We all had the wonderful luck of following Paul for many, many years, whether he knew it or not. For somebody like me, I was able to follow Paul from afar and then finally able to work with him. I only worked with Paul for about 2 months before he retired, before that broadcast that you saw there. And many of you have been sharing personal stories about Paul, and we'll hear more throughout the evening, I'm sure. But I'd like to talk a little bit about what Paul meant for Financial News. You know, when you work closely with somebody, I think you don't always recognize the kind of legacy, that was a word used earlier, but the kind of legacy that they can leave. I think we do a pretty good job of recognizing what Paul's legacy is, but I want to talk a little bit about that because, frankly, I don't think it can be underestimated, the kind of impact that Paul had and continues to leave on Financial News. As mentioned many times, Paul began in 1979. The stock market was a fraction of what it is today. The benchmark government bond interest rate, 10%. Imagine that, right? 401k was only 1 year old. Stocks were still priced in fractions. How quaint. Paul was the voice for the market for millions of Americans each and every night. He was one of the founding fathers of modern financial television journalism. Yeah, there was Rukeyser. He was on only once a week. Then there was a guy, Kandel. He was on cable television. It was Paul. Paul was on. If the market was open that day, Paul was on your television that night walking you through all the hits, runs, and errors. Each trading day, he found the spirit, he found the insight, and he also included it with his unabashed love of puns in those stock reports. Through the years, the stock market certainly moved higher. I swear that his glasses got smaller as the market moved up. You saw the archival video. He was that steady presence in the boom and bust times. Jack mentioned that fateful evening in October 1987. Boy, he retraced that awful day, rapid fire style, but it was all there, sprinkling in the context when you needed it to be sure that you understood what was happening, the short bursts of phrases and insight like a master chef uses salt, only when necessary and only to bring out the essence of the message. You can still hear echoes, I think, in the market reporting that Paul pioneered even today. And frankly, I wish there were more echoes today of Paul's steady demeanor. He was graceful and efficient in his words. I don't think Paul necessarily thought of himself as a writer, but boy, I think he really was. He was quite a master with words, and he was only concerned with the financial facts. His was not the voice of speculation or conjecture. He wasn't necessarily interested in opinion. There was no room for fake news for Paul. Johnny, could you imagine the conversations in the office these days about fake news with Paul? He would have no patience for it whatsoever, and rightfully so. If you had an opinion, certainly you better express it, but you better have your facts to support it and back it up. He wasn't argumentative. He just wanted to know why you believed in what you believe. In the few weeks that I was lucky enough to work with Paul and see that relationship that Rodney mentioned between Paul and Johnny, I was a lucky, lucky man. It was clear to me that even after 30 years of stock reports, even after thousands and thousands of recantations of daily market activity, he remained true to his knitting each and every night. He wanted his audience not only to merely know the numbers, not just the data. That wasn't enough for Paul. He wanted the audience to know why that data was important, and to put it in context, to give voice to it, and to share his passion for capitalism. That's what Paul brought to the television screen each and every night. Mark, there's many ways to measure a life. I think one is reflected by this room here tonight, and for folks taking time out of their lives to share memories of Paul with you. Another is how those beyond the walls of this immediate studio will remember Paul, and they will remember Paul. His legacy will remain alive and well with each and every one of us, and many of us that have gone beyond these studio walls. We all carry an image of Paul with us each and every day. Sometimes not as quite large as that one looking over our shoulders, but we all have an idea of what Paul meant to all of us. The market reporter, the insightful stock market commentator, the boy from the Youper, the golfer, the ham radio operator. The image that I remember was several months after retirement. Paul had stayed away from the newsroom. He was very respectful, and he came back. It had been a tough several months. His beloved wife had passed away. It had been very hard. But he came in with a sparkle in his eye and what today can only be described as a Letterman beard. You know what I mean by the Letterman beard? The retirement, the TV retirement, don't have to shave every day beard. For those of us that have been on television, Jeff, you know it as well. You take that time and put the razor away for a while. There he was in the doorway. Johnny and I were talking to him about the market activity. He wanted to know about some market monitors and what they had talked about. Clearly interested in precious metals, as Paul always was. And scraggly beard, sparkle in his eye, and I looked down, and I swear he had Crocs on. Crocs on. That's the image that I'm going to keep with me of Paul Kangas. Thank you very much for the time. It is so wonderful to celebrate his life and his legacy with all of you, and Mark especially with you. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom, and all for all these great memories. Susie, Rodney, Jack, just you really take us back. Such great memories. So a couple of weeks ago, I was at a public broadcasting conference, and I'm getting to know a lot more about engineering than I ever wanted to know. I'm a content person. What am I learning about repacking and ATSC 3.0 and all these things? Anyway, so I run into this gentleman from T-Mobile, who's very senior person there, and he's telling me about the convergence and broadcasting. And anyway, he sends me an email afterwards and says, I grew up in Miami, and as a high school student, I watched Paul Kangas every night, and he said I was a day trader. And really, the highlight of his life was having his picture taken with Paul and Johnny. You can see the little bow tie, high school student, amazing. And so this is not a great picture, but I blew it up from my little email. But so here, how many lives like that? There's a senior executive with T-Mobile who learned about stocks from Paul Kangas, learned about finance, learned about business. And Johnny, where are you? Johnny, come up here. Johnny was a great team player, and as Rodney said, he had a very, very special bond with Paul Kangas, and we thank you so much.
Did I get a kiss?
Yes, you do. It is so good to see you, Johnny.
Well,
so
thank you very, very much.
And keep this picture.
Please, trust me, my wife would not believe it.
That's right.
Don't go far, I may need you. This is truly more like a family reunion than anything else. So forgive me if I focus here, because I don't want too much of here to come out and ruin this beautiful broadcast that we have that I'm lucky enough to be a part of. Now, looking back, I recall one of my first conversations with him included a lesson on the term blue chip. In hindsight, it turned out to be a defining moment, one which solidified my view of him as one character-wise. Now, after all, in a fatherly fashion, he was the suavest man who'd seen it all, gave sound advice, a class act, equitable, well-respected in the investment community, and welcomed in boardrooms, man caves, and sports bars before they were called that. Now, this may sound a little silly, but I actually considered him publicly held by the viewing audience and privately held by, well, all of us. Booking guest market monitors was easy. They were always anxious and excited to see Paul again. Now, anyone who has ever studied journalism has heard of the term inverted pyramid. where you pack all the essential information at the top. This gives you options to tailor script to fit within the time allowed. Now, in news, you get what you get. You work hard together to make it clear and concise to get it all in. Now, the same can be said for life. For 30 years, it was admirable how he artfully made magic in 3 to 4 minutes. At the outset, he always aimed for the most he could get and was graceful to cut as he needed. Sometimes it was bittersweet. Now, whether we're talking investments, after the bittersweet, it became absolutely crystal clear by the shape of the glass of his favorite drink, the distilling process, and the ultimate potency of its key ingredient. In broader context, this had less to do with finance and more to do with time. Now, whether we are talking investments, ambitions, or relationships, the determination to make the most out of time in the time allowed can give you quite a buzz and keep you in good spirits. It's no wonder he chose from time to time to enjoy a martini or two. The drink could be fully appreciated in both bull and bear markets. On one hand, to toast and celebrate the end of a long week with a strong finish on Wall Street, or for medicinal purposes when all you saw was red. Now, I'm not sure how you are going to respond to this, but I really wanted to share this. And I also wanted you to know, I spent some time with him over the weekend at a nature walk in Delray. I can see some may be uneasy or appear a little puzzled and maybe even concerned, but I assure you, this wasn't an Elvis sighting. It was more like a scene from a sci-fi movie where in just a few steps, I found myself back in time, seated in B control, operating Chiron and waiting for his cue. I can't stress enough how real this was. It was just him and I. I was doing stocks and I was advancing the boards. As he proceeded to run down the most active and widely held, I quickly noticed these were not publicly traded issues he was reporting on. It was rather a hard graphic look at all the up and down arrows I caused. As I wandered ahead of my family, it wasn't long before I was fully engulfed in tears. For the big winners, I received a proud five-finger chop, which actually appeared more like a high five for approval of a nice job. Those that were unchanged, he gave me the pointer finger, indicating sometimes it feels like no matter what, you're right back where you started from, but enjoy the pause. It wouldn't always be that way. As for those in the minus column, these were the ones dreadfully singled out with the middle finger because, Johnny, you could have done better. And if you continue, there is more downside risk. In reality, it was a sobering thought not to idealize money, but to take time to enjoy those things with sentimental value. You see, when it came to the good, the bad, or the ugly, Paul always gave it to me straight. Now, when I came to, I found myself near the end of the boardwalk and not sure how I got there. It wasn't long before my daughter caught up and she found me staring out over a lake, and I began to share an observation. Did you know diamonds dance regularly at a massive ball held by the sun on the brightest of days? Showtimes vary on ponds, lakes, rivers, and beaches, and everyone is invited. Now, to my surprise, she replied, "My silver tongue, daddy." Then I thought, well, in closing, I want to say something finished, but honestly, the only thing I felt that was appropriate was go Fins, right? But then I thought, Poyos Maizen Bluip Ustavani, Kitos Nain Selavaste Nut, which simply means to my Nordic blue chip friend, thanks. I can see clearly now.
That was beautiful, Johnny. And I remember so clearly how Paul would change the stocks boards. And it was probably Johnny in the control room who would have to keep up with him. And he'd go like that and like that. And then he'd have the telex in his ear, and people were talking to him and giving him timing, and he never missed a beat, constantly. And the other thing I wanted to say, Johnny, you talked about his vodka, his drink. He went up to New York on this one trip and interviewed the president of the NASDAQ. And somehow, and I can't remember the details, but somehow it came back, they named the NASDAQ-ery, and it was, Paul, do you remember that? That came back, he was so excited, we have a new drink, the NASDAQ-ery, and that was a Paul Kangas signature drink. So yes, he knew how to do all that, and really do it well, with style. So next up is Jeff Yasteen, and Jeff anchored on NBR, he worked with Paul, he served up as his backup for many, many years. So Jeff, would you please come up and share some thoughts about Paul?
Boy, when I look at those old tapes of Paul, I start thinking, did he really talk that fast? My gosh, I remember the first time that I had to sit in for him, and you know, I don't forget how many stocks Paul went through in the course of his Stocks 2 segment, but I must have only gotten through about two-thirds of them. There's no way I could cover. No, I can't talk that fast even now. But how do we remember somebody who was so memorable? And there's two things that come to mind for me. One is the generosity of Paul's knowledge. Nowadays, you know, with the smartphones and everything else, it's easy to forget how long it used to take to develop expertise on a specialized area of knowledge. It took time. You needed to know people, and you needed to spend a lot of time in the library, basically. So in 1993, I was the newest member of the NBR editorial staff. And I remember, you know, at the time thinking, wow, you know, this is great. This is where I want to be. But I really didn't know that much about the stock market at the time. So over the course of probably the next 6 or 8 months, I wore a well-worn path to Paul's office on the carpet in that old bowling alley NVR newsroom. And every day when Paul would come in, I'd be there with a couple of questions, or it seemed like every day anyway. And when I think about the kind of questions I was asking, I almost cringe now, because it's like, Paul, what's a price earnings ratio? Paul, what does X dividend mean? But you know, nowadays you could look that up on Investopedia if you didn't know anything. Paul was our Investopedia. You know, he was our guy. And he could have easily been forgiven for responding, you know, yelling over to Barry Nemkov, our managing editor, and saying, you know, Barry, where are we getting these new reporters at, you know? But he did not. He responded with all the wisdom of a professor and the patience of a father. You know, he really responded that way and was happy to, despite trying to prepare for his program, was happy to explain things to me in such a way as until I was satisfied. And through that process, you know, it rapidly accelerated, you know, my ability to know something about the market. And, you know, I treasure that time period to this day. And I've told other people here, I wouldn't be doing what I'm doing in the investment newsletter business without having had Paul as my first tutor. And for that, I'm obviously always very, very appreciative. The other thing that I remember about Paul, and many of us have spoken to this already, is the strength and charisma and authenticity of his personality. And of course, as we all know, he brought that to the program every single night. And as Tom was relating, I've had people come up to me at investment conferences, and you know, they'll hear, you know, they used to work at the program. They may not always get the name of the program right. It'll be Nightly Business Review, Nightly Business Hour, other things like that. But they're like, Paul Kangas, that's the man. Like, yep, that's definitely the man. He was the man. I remember once interviewing at one of the early Republican primaries. I guess it must have been 2008. They had it in Boca, I think at Lynn University. And I remember interviewing Chuck Todd from NBC, and at the time he was just basically a back office guy for Tim Russert. He was the political director, but you know, he wasn't Chuck Todd on-air correspondent yet. And I remember Chuck Todd relating to me how, you know, he grew up in Miami, and Nightly Business Report with Paul Kangas, that was, you know, appointment viewing for him and his family. And the other thing I think about even now is when you know, I'll go on YouTube sometimes, and I'm astonished by the number of videos of Paul that people have uploaded to YouTube. And you can tell clearly it's not digital stuff that they recorded, you know, off their cable box. It's a VHS tape that was in the back of a, you know, of a drawer someplace gathering dust, and somehow they had the wherewithal to digitize it, and it might be fuzzy and waving in and out and have static and dropouts on it, but yet, why do they do it? If you go on there, there's dozens, there might even be several hundred of these uploads on YouTube of Paul. Paul in the 1987 crash. Paul on just an everyday, you know, ho-hum period of the market. And why do they do that? And I think it's really because of Paul's authenticity. And, you know, that is what we most remember. I mean, Paul Kangas, an American original. Thanks.
He truly was an original. Thank you, Jeff. And next up, we're going to hear from the leader of WPBT for many, for decades, who really started this organization. And George Dooley was president of WPBT too when Nightly Business Report started. He was a longtime friend and fan of Paul. He was one of his biggest supporters. He couldn't be with us this evening, but he sent along this message. George Dooley.
Hi. I'm sorry I couldn't be with you tonight, but I want to thank Dolores and Jeff and Mike Malanga, our NBR shooter, for making this video possible. I know we're here to remember Paul Kangas, and I'd like to share with you a little vignette that occurred between Paul and I many years ago. In the 1950s, we developed a 15-minute stock market report called Stocks and Bonds with Dick Davis. Now, Dick was a local radio commentator who gave a report on the stock market daily happenings Monday through Friday on Channel 2 at about 6 p.m. When I got the idea of expanding NBR to a half-hour program, I began to put a staff together, and I talked to Dick Davis about coming on as the new stock market reporter on NBR. Well, Dick and I went around and around at meetings, and we never could get to an agreement for a contract. So I started to look elsewhere. I heard about Paul Kangas, who was on radio station WINZ in Miami, who gave a 4 or 5 reports daily about the stock market. I heard him, he sounded good on the radio. So we called him in, talked to him, gave him an audition, put him on camera, and he looked good. I talked to Paul about a contract. It happened just like that, no problem. Well, shortly before the new NBR went on the air, the publicity department sent out a report or a press release, and the Miami Herald picked it up. The current reporter for radio and television, Jack Anderson of the Miami Herald, called me and said, George, I've got one question. How come all those years you used Dick Davis on Stocks and Bonds, you're not using him on NBR? I said, well, Jack, we talked and talked, but he was just too expensive and we couldn't afford him. Well, they published the story and Jack quoted me. The next day, Paul calls me and says, what are you saying that for? It makes me look cheap. Now, Paul was thrifty, parsimonious, frugal, but he wasn't cheap. Although he did drive that Chevrolet clunker for about 25 years and we put gas in it every 2 weeks, he said the price of it went up. So, Paul, you aren't cheap. And we never had a problem after that. We played golf together and he usually won with that phony handicap and I had to buy him all those martinis. So I'm glad you're all here to remember Paul, and I'll always remember him. Have a good time.
Thank you, George Dooley. And I had never heard that story. That's great. I guess there's a newspaper article about it. Well, we have another message from another Dooley, and this Dooley is Kevin Dooley, who spent several years in the chair directing Nightly Business Report. Kevin Dooley.
Hi, this is Kevin Dooley, and I was very privileged to work with Paul both in the studio environment at Channel 2 and the control room as his director for NBR for many years. And I will certainly miss his good nature and witty charm. And not only I will miss Paul, but my entire family will miss him as well. We knew Paul quite well, and he will certainly be missed by the Dooleys.
Well, thank you from the Dooleys. They were both great comments. Many NBR team members have been sharing their Paul stories on social media in recent weeks, and it has been so heartwarming to hear all of these stories. And we'd like to open the floor right now to anyone here who would like to share his or her favorite memories on Paul tonight. So please, please join us. I see Merwin Seigal, who was the original co-anchor of Nightly Business Report. Would you like to say a few words? Great to see you. It's been
a long time.
Thank you.
Thank you. Well, Paul was a phenomenon, as you all know. And I guess, as I sat at the anchor desk with Linda when we started this program, I was humbled by Paul. You know, we were reporting on something that was new in American television, and that is a focus on business and financial news. I remember when I came up through journalism school that the worst thing, the worst assignment that any new reporter could get in any medium was to cover business. It's considered dull, unimportant, nobody very much interested in it. And as Linda mentioned earlier, things happened in the 1970s, the oil price shocks, the internationalization, the global economy getting underway, and business and finance suddenly became quite important. And yet, when we started, we talked about these crises, and we had the sense that we're informing people about things they didn't really know all that much about, but it wasn't really very personal. And then Paul would come out, and he'd rattle off this long list of stock market prices. And it occurred to me then, it occurs to me again now, that every time he mentioned a stock, somebody out there in the audience said, "Wow, that's my money. I just made some money." Or, "Oh, no, I just lost some money." So in all those numbers out there, there really was a personal connection with a lot of people with every little factoid that he would come up with. And in my mind, that sort of overshadowed the crises that we were talking about that were so general and not impacting individuals in the audience. So he lent a dimension that we couldn't lend, but all together we had a package that I think did make an impact. And when it went national, that impact grew even more. And Paul's part in that continued. Even at the national level, more people than could hear him in Miami were saying, "Wow, I just made money." That affects me personally. So.
Thank you. And do we have some others who would like to join us this evening? Come on, Mark. Mark Landsman, who one of our senior managers at NBR for many years and a stellar career with network CBS especially.
I just wanted to make a couple points. I've said to people tonight that what happened here, and Paul was the engine of it, was magic. We're all magicians. I go back so far as to spending 25 years with NBC. And I can tell you, in all of those 25 years, nobody thought that business news was worth anything. You couldn't visualize it, couldn't tell the story. People got it in the morning when they read the stock pages. When Irving R. Levine, who was one of our commentators and an old colleague of mine, when Irving R. Levine was brought back by NBC to Washington, they didn't know what to do with him. So some genius decided, let him cover business. And Irving did a pretty damn good job covering business. But there was no CNBC. There was just nothing. It was a vacuum. And out of that vacuum came Nightly Business Report. You know, when people found out that this program was coming from a public television station in North Miami, if they had false teeth, they dropped them. But it's true. We made history here. He made history here. And what Paul did was something that you see going on in the world today, and that is journalists striving to win trust and earn trust. Well, he did. He knew what he was talking about, and he was a good communicator, and he was a magician. He made a magician of our engineers, who made a rinky-dink control room do things it shouldn't be doing. We had Jeff and his band making visuals that shouldn't be coming out of North Miami. We had contributors like Linda and Susie, who all were part of the magical act, and it worked. So I just want to point out to everybody here, you've heard great things about Paul tonight, and you all know that when Paul ended his program, he said the best of goodbyes. What we know is he was really the best of good guys. Thank you.
That is wonderful. Thank you, Mark. Anyone else who would like to come up? Well, thank you. Thank you for sharing such wonderful memories. And before we close, I want to thank our crew members working behind the scenes tonight, many of whom spent years working with Paul and the NBR team. Carmelo Rodriguez. Carmelo started at NBR as a studio intern, and then he was hired as a camera operator, moving on to the control room as an assistant director, and finally to senior director. Melissa Harmon, who has been so instrumental in organizing tonight's event, started with NBR as a freelance writer. She was eventually hired as an associate producer and then worked her way up through the NBR producing ranks to become the program's last senior producer and showrunner before it left the building. Ms. Bell Vargas-Leal. Ms. Bell started as a Chiron operator, moving on to assistant director, then director. Erlen Morandiera. Erlen started as a studio intern, and then he was hired as camera operator, eventually becoming the assistant director. Keith Lester served as a camera operator and floor manager. Jeremy Nicholson. Jeremy started working on NBR as a camera operator and editor for the Morning Business Report, and he's still a top editor and shooter for South Florida PBS. Rob Reap and Norman Silva, broadcast graphic designers. Rob and Norman worked very closely with Denise Bender on creating the daily graphics for NBR. Jim Mathis. Jim started with NBR as tape operator, and then he became audio engineer and eventually a technical director. Dave Fahey. Dave started working on NBR as a tape operator and eventually became the technical director. Maria Halpern. Maria started on NBR as a tape operator and moved on to audio and then technical director. And Jose Jimenez. Jose took care of the uplink every night, making sure the program went up on that bird for air. He also cared for NBR's equipment, both here and in the bureaus. And Fiona Scott, art director. Fiona worked closely with Jim Fasilis, the late Jim Fasilis, with Lynn Tierney and Marilyn Hudson, all on working with NBR marketing materials. They are all working here. They have made what you see possible. And thank you for all that you do every day, but especially for tonight. I also wanted to say greetings from Stuart Zuckerman, our colleague from New York, who worked so hard on the marketing for NBR for so many years. And he has been very active on social media and wishes you all well. You know, in so many ways, Paul was the face of NBR, and he made his mark not just for public television, but for the nation. He and a number of people right here in this room, as we've heard, invented the genre of business news on television. As Mark said, it was before CNN, before CNBC, it was before the internet. We used typewriters then, and the old whiteboard. Paul pioneered daily stock market commentary on television, and he did so while never forgetting the most important part of the equation, and that was the viewer. Paul's legacy is represented right here in this room with all of you, as well as the millions of viewers who depended on his financial wisdom. We are all a little better for having known Paul Kangas. God bless you. We want to leave you tonight with Paul's closing that we've heard about and remembered so fondly. This was the closing from his last program on December 31st, 2009.
Well, as I end my long career with NBR, let me go back to the beginning and compliment George Dooley, the founder and longtime president of WPBT2 Public TV in Miami, for recognizing the need for more business news on television back in the late 1970s. He decided it was time to put together a pilot program and had the good judgment to select Linda O'Brien to develop it. We know she did an exemplary job, and I'm proud to have been part of it right from the start. Like many public TV productions, NBR did not have deep pockets, but we were lucky in finding people with a deep devotion toward building it into the best daily program dedicated strictly to business news. Interestingly, many of the people who joined us when we were just a pup are now still with us now that we've all grown up. I'd like to give a special mention to my longtime stocks producer, Johnny Streets, who can coax more information out of a computer or a telephone than anyone anywhere to explain why certain stocks are moving either up or down or not moving at all, despite a major development. He certainly made my job easier over the years, and I want to thank you personally, Johnny. Actually, there isn't a person on the Nightly Business Report staff, including in our bureaus, that I wouldn't like to single out for being outstanding and a credit to our goal of being the best business news program of all time. But time constraints prevent that. However, they must have heard my personal mantra, which goes like this: good, better, best, never let it rest, till the good is better and the better is the best. And speaking of the best, there's my beautiful wife, Penny, who from the day I joined Nightly Business Report was supportive and helpful in every way imaginable. And yes, I confess that she's the one who buys the ties that have brought so many compliments from our viewers. Thank you for all your help, Penny. Let me also extend my sincere gratitude to you, our viewers, who have been most supportive over the years. I must tell you that most all of the viewer criticism we've received has been of a constructive nature, much of which has been incorporated into the program format. And of course, I thank those who have made donations to the PBS system, making programs like Nightly Business Report possible. With that, I bid farewell, look forward to the new challenges ahead, and for the last time on Nightly Business Report, I extend to all of you my wishes for the very best of goodbyes.